Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, and to all those who are keeping the Sabbath, I say Shabbat Shalom, keeping the all-important Sabbath a true blessing. Now, today I'm going to talk about presumptuous sin. This is a retake from last week. I had some computer issues and subsequently had to replace my computer. So I'm going to redo this video, this lesson for you today. It's important to understand that those who know the truth are Satan's special targets. He's stealthily working to confuse the minds of those who know the truth by bringing them into what? Into misleading sentiments and misleading examples, always trying to mislead us and knock us off track. So, unless those who know the truth repent, you must repent and be converted. And I'm speaking about those who are living the divided lives. Those who know the truth and are professedly living and serving the Almighty, but at the same time, they're scheming to carry out their own personal plans, living their life any way they want to, disgracing the very work that our Savior gave His life for. So, those are the ones who will be the most deceived by the enemy to their own ruin. You must come away from your own thing, especially if you profess to doing the Father's thing. Now, understand that Satan is continually watching for unguarded minds. Unguarded minds. He's watching to find a mind that is in an unguarded moment or condition to do what? To get possession of it. See, we cannot afford to be ignorant of his devices. He's sneaky, he's clever, he's subtle, he's all that. And we don't want to be overpowered by him and his tricks. One thing that the enemy is most pleased with are all those depictions and pictures that represent him with horns and hooves. Why? Well, one, he has intelligence. And you have to remember that he was once an angel of light. The Father's word describes him to us in Leviticus 28, amongst other places, but it describes how beautiful he was as the anointed cherub that covereth. We have been deceived into always looking for a hideous creature. Why not being on guard for the deception shrouded in something of beauty? Nowhere in the word does it tell us that the adversary is or has been changed to some kind of monster. This is all man's doing. We see it in movies, books, and everywhere. And this is a deception to our own detriment. We have to be careful of these perceptions. If we permit the evil angels or demons, they will captivate and control the minds of every man until they have no mind or will of their own. Our only safety is giving no place to the enemy. Ephesians 4:27 tells us, neither give place to the devil. We have to be on guard, people. I'm telling you. Look. His suggestions and purposes are ever to do what? To injure us and hinder us from relying upon our Heavenly Father. He is the only one who can protect us. And if the devil can keep us from relying on him, we are at his beck and call. We are at the will of his devices. Remember what John 10:10 tells us. It reads, "The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it," what? More abundantly. That's what the word tells us, and we know the Father is true to his word. Understand, Satan transforms himself into an angel of purity that he may, through his misleading and beautiful temptations, introduce his devices in such a manner that we may not discern his tricks, his wiles, his deceptions, and people fall for this all the time. Look, the more we yield, the more powerful will be his deceptions over us. It is always inadvisable and unsafe to controvert or get into some kind of a discussion with the enemy. See, we can't argue and debate with the enemy and expect that we're going to come out okay. That puts him at an advantage when you get into this kind of controversy with him, just like Eve in the garden. For every advantage we give the enemy, he'll do what? He will claim more. Our only safety is to reject him firmly at the first insinuation or presumption. We must. The Father has given us grace through the merits of His Son, Yeshua, and it will always be sufficient to withstand Satan and be more than conquerors against him. Ephesians 4:7 reads like this, "But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ." He has given this to us as what? As a gift. It is a gift. Yet, many don't accept it and use it against the enemy. They just fall into the tricks of the enemy. Resistance of the enemy is our success. That's what we must keep in mind. James 4:7 reads, "Resist the devil and what? And he will flee from you." Resist him. Don't say that the Father's word is not working if the enemy doesn't flee from you. There's something else going on if it doesn't work. See, resistance, one, must be firm and steadfast. We lose all we gain if we resist today and only yield to the same temptation tomorrow. We canceled it out. We gained nothing. Now, let's talk about presumptuous acts. This is something that we must really pay close attention to. In the name of fun, excitement, thrill-seeking, and entertainment, there are always those of us who will recklessly place ourselves in scenes of danger and peril and expose ourselves to temptations, out of which it would take a miracle from the Father Himself to bring us through it unharmed or untainted. These things we do are presumptuous, and these are things in which the Father is not pleased. Don't ever think the Father is pleased with us placing ourselves in situations of danger. Don't believe for a moment that He condones us putting ourselves at risk. And don't ever think that it is acceptable in the name of fun, entertainment, or thrill seeking. His word teaches us about this. Remember Satan's temptation to the Savior of the world to cast himself from the pinnacle of the temple was firmly met and resisted. Look, the arch enemy quoted a promise of the Almighty Himself as security that the Savior might with safety what? Do this on the strength of that promise. See, Yeshua, He met the enemy's temptation with what? With scripture. And this is what we must do. Let's look at Matthew 4, and we're going to read 5 through 11. Matthew 4, 5 through 11. Starting with verse 5, it reads, "Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple, and saith to him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, He shall give His angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou shalt dash thy foot against a stone." See, this is the trick that the enemy was trying on our Savior. But see, this is what he said, verse 7. Jesus, or Yeshua, said unto him, It is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. So hold up for a minute. When the enemy, when the adversary says, jump off this cliff, the angels will save you. Now, that's like saying, jump off this cliff with this parachute on, the angels will save you. But what did the Father's Son say? He said, it is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. So see, when people are doing things in the name of fun and excitement, like jumping off cliffs with parachutes on, we're tempting the Father. But one thing to clearly understand is He has no hand in this. So when people jump out of planes, off cliffs, or whatever, roller coasters, or whatever we're doing, things that are dangerous in the name of fun and excitement, when these things fail, dealing with the enemy. The Father says, I will not be tempted, and we shouldn't tempt Him. He cannot be tempted. Now, verse 8 reads, "Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, and the glory of them, and saith unto him, All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me." So now, the enemy is saying, if you bow down to me, if you do what I want you to do, I'll give you all this stuff. Sounds like the world to me. Verse 10. Then saith Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. See, everything the enemy tries to tempt him with, the same with us. Everything he tries to tempt us with, and the reward on the other end, the Father has addressed it. We are not to play this game with the enemy. See, Yeshua was not conversing or parlaying with the enemy. As soon as the devil says something, he threw scripture at him. And this is what we must do. We must flee him at the first insinuation. Verse 11, then the devil leaveth him, and bam, behold, angels came and ministered unto him. So it shows us how pleased the Father will be with us and what he will do for us when we do according to his word. We must rebuke the enemy. We must use scripture against him. We must not get into that kind of a controversy with him. And the Father will bless us. He came and ministered to his son. See, the Father will take care of us when we do according to his will, according to his word. So understand, in the same way, Satan urges us to go into places or situations where the Father doesn't require us to go. But he's doing the opposite. He's using scripture to justify his suggestions. See, and this is where people get tripped up. They, under the delusion that it's safe, it's secure, it's going to be okay, because the Father wouldn't let something happen to one of his. See, this is Satan and how he has justified us interpreting the promises of the Father to justify doing his bidding, to justify putting ourselves at risk. The promises of the Almighty are not for us to claim rashly to protect us as we rush off into danger or violating the laws of nature or disregarding smart judgment, common sense, or what have you. The Father has given this to us to say, hey, common sense tells me that's not a good thing to do. But see, when we're looking to justify, we're doing Satan's bidding. We're justifying based on the promises of the Father, and he's not having any part of that. We're dealing with the enemy. We're bidding and siding with the enemy. And understand, people, this is not genuine faith. This is presumption when we place ourselves in situations that are not safe, that are risky, that are dangerous, what have you. This is totally presumption. Now, when tragedy happens, we want to cry out to the Father and ask, why? Why did this happen to my brother, sister, mother, father, son, daughter, whomever? We have to understand, a lot of times the answer is because we were presumptuous. We entered into presumptuous sin. And at the same time we were in this sin, we tried to hold the Father to his promise while falling to a temptation without expectation of suffering consequences if it went wrong. We cannot afford to trifle with the Father and his word. Look, Satan comes to us with worldly honor, wealth, and pleasures of life, things, stuff, whatever. These temptations vary to meet every man of every rank, position, stature, degree, or whatever. And he does this to tempt us away from the Father to serve ourselves more than the Creator. See, if we're serving ourselves, we're serving the enemy. So that's fine with him for us to think that we're serving ourselves, doing what we want to do. Remember, all these things will I give thee, said Satan to Yeshua, our Savior. All these things will I give thee, said Satan to man, or says Satan to man, to you, to me, to anyone who will listen. All this money, this land, all this power, honor, success, riches, stuff, I'll give this to you if you do this. And see, we become easily charmed and deceived and treacherously allured unto our own ruin by listening to the wiles of the enemy. Look at all the successful and powerful stars, entertainers, athletes, some of your friends, neighbors, whomever, who have fallen serving the enemy or for themselves and not the Father with all these blessings and things. They were serving themselves. They were caught up in their own success. People continually think that all these wonderful things that they are being blessed with are coming from the Almighty Himself. But yet, Satan says, all these things will I give thee. This comes straight out of the Word. So understand, Satan can bless us with stuff and things. All we have to do is listen to him. Don't always think that all the blessings and things that you see others receiving and getting are coming from the Father. So don't be jealous of that mess. Don't be envious of it. Satan may be very well blessing them to their own ruin. See, the Father will give us what we need. He will watch over us and protect us and provide to sustain us. Now, if he blesses us with more, what? More is required of us. So be careful of that when we receive blessings from him. Because if we take the blessings from him and don't do what we're supposed to, he will turn us over to the enemy and allow us to come face to face with our own one in that regard. And plenty have done it. Look, either the evil angels or the angels of the Almighty are controlling the minds of men, controlling your mind, controlling what you do. Our minds are given to the control of the Father or to the control of the powers of darkness. As simple as that. And it would be well for us to inquire and question ourselves at every turn as to who we're standing for. Today, ask yourself, who am I serving with what I have? Who am I serving with what I don't have? Who am I serving with what I desire to have? Understand who you're serving and work that route accordingly. Whether you're under the blood-stained banner of our Savior or under the black banner of the powers of darkness, you better know and understand who you're working for. Remember, Satan cannot touch our mind or our intellect unless we yield it to him, unless we give it to him. Always know that the prayer of faith is the great strength of the believer and will assuredly and always prevail against the enemy. Always. This is why he always insinuates that we have no need for prayer. And just look at where prayer used to be and where it's all been removed from. So it's up to you as an individual to get your one-on-one with the Father. Because if you leave it to man, because so many of them are under the influence of the enemy, you'll never pray or you'll never use prayer against the enemy. See, the name of our Savior, Yeshua, our advocate, the enemy hates it. He detests it. And when we earnestly, when we honestly, and when we faithfully go to him for help, Satan and his hosts are alarmed. They flee. So it serves his purpose if we neglect the exercise of prayer. Because then his lying wonders are more readily received by us. That which he failed to accomplish in tempting the Savior, he accomplishes by setting forth these same deceitful little tricks of temptation and disaster before man. James 1:13 reads, "Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempted he any man." Understand that, people. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. It's all up to us. We fall into our own temptations. And with that, remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.